If any of y'all remember from last week, this game has a lot of aftermarket lighting that I'm going to remove from it, and whoever installed it did a pretty good job, but they used a Molex connector here to make it so I could unplug the lamps if I were to need to remove this plastic to service the multi-ball launcher unit, which is right here. But instead of just cutting the wires, I have a tool here that is made to remove these 0.093 pins inside of this housing right here. It's a hollow tool.
Okay.
And what you'll it pushes the barbs that hold them in the housing in. So you can use it to pinch around the pin and push. And that way, since I'll be removing this, I could save this and use this on another project that might need
Molex housing. Oh, wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Very cool. So that's a very handy thing to always keep in your pinball toolbox, I imagine.
Yeah, especially if you're doing a lot of electronics work. There's three different sizes for those Molex pins, so there's three tools you'd need to kind of cover the entire gambit, but it's a really handy thing to have. Adjusting slingshot switches. Let's kill the game and let's get in here and show this. I'm going to get a switch adjuster. I am going to get a screwdriver. I'm going to get my bendy one because it's handy. Okay, so let's try to frame this guy right here, if that's possible. It might be a little far away, but I mentioned up at the top how rubbers, when you install a new rubber, they're tighter, right? So the gap that these switches were adjusted for, which were good for the old loose rubbers, might not be ideal for this. And I can see here that the rubber is very close. The switch is very close. So what you'll have, people call it like the machine gun effect. The kicker will come forward, and then it will slam back, and that rubber rebound will close the switch again, and you'll get that happening.
Right.
So when this is the perfect time to check for that kind of stuff, instead of putting everything back together and then realizing, oh crap, I have to take it all back apart again. I'm going to get in here and just use my switch adjuster. You should do this from the bottom, but this is a small adjustment I need to make. I'm going to just bend it back a teeny bit. And I've created a gap that's maybe 1 millimeter wide. Sorry, I don't... metric is a little bit easier for me to measure those small gaps, so it's small. But what you want to make sure is that it has enough of a gap to open and close, but you also want to make sure that the gap is small enough so a good glance will make it fire. Good slingshot action makes a game more fun and difficult. So one thing you can do, again, it's like I didn't take pictures when I took this apart, but I wanted to reinforce, like, there's things you can do to remember where things go without needing to take pictures. This game uses a lot of like metal sleeves. It also uses posts. But you can see around where a lot of these posts went, like if we could get a zoom in on that, if it zooms in far enough, you can see a witness mark right here of where this wide bottom post used to go. So you know, obviously, right, okay, I got to put a post here. If you see the witness marks where the metal posts go, they're a lot smaller. So you can look and see, you know, what was there without needing to have a photo, if you forgot to take one or whatnot. Like, especially... If you got a game and you don't know, you got it taken apart, you adopted someone's project or something like that, and you didn't have any posts on there, how can you tell where things are supposed to go, right? This is the piece of plastic that goes on top of this lane right here. And since I had been putting some incorrect screws on with those studs, I wanted to come in here and check. Okay, so, you know, do we need a studded screw on top of this lane guide right here? If we lay the plastic in place, that'll tell us what hardware we need through these certain studs. This absolutely does not need a post. So I'll need to take that out, replace it with a screw. But you can see, you can use this to your advantage when you, again, when you have everything off, if you forgot, if you took a bunch of pictures, but of course the one picture you don't have is the one place that you really need some help remembering where things went. You can use those witness marks once again in the plastic.
Yeah. Be a pinball detective.
Yeah. Or archaeologist or something, you know.
Oh, sure. Archaeologist.
That's my favorite term. I like to tell people that. I'm a pinball archaeologist. I'm like, what? What do you mean? One tool that I used, and I want to link people to, this is a super handy tool. If any of y'all remember from last week, this game has a lot of aftermarket lighting that I'm going to remove from it. And whoever installed it did a pretty good job, but they used a Molex connector here to... One tool that I used, and I want to link people to, this is a super handy tool. If any of y'all remember from last week, this game has a lot of aftermarket lighting that I'm going to remove from it. And whoever installed it did a pretty good job, but they used a Molex connector here to make it so I could unplug the lamps if I were to need to remove this plastic to service the multi-ball launcher unit, which is right here. But instead of just cutting the wires, I have a tool here that is made to remove these 0.093 pins inside of this housing right here. It's a hollow tool,
okay.
And what you'll do is it pushes the barbs that hold them in the housing in, so you can use it to pinch around the pin and push. And that way, since I'll be removing this, I could save this and use this on another project that might need a Molex housing.
Oh wow, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Very cool. So that's a very handy thing to always keep in your pinball toolbox, I imagine.
Yeah, especially if you're doing a lot of electronics work. There's three different sizes for those Molex pins, so there's three tools you'd need to kind of cover the entire gambit, but it's a really handy thing to have. Adjusting slingshot switches. Let's kill the game and let's get in here and show this. I'm going to get a switch adjuster. I am going to get a screwdriver. I'm going to get my bendy one because it's handy. Okay, so let's try to frame this guy right here if that's possible. It might be a little far away, but I mentioned up at the top how rubbers, when you install a new rubber, they're tighter, right? So the gap that these switches were adjusted for, which were good for the old loose rubbers, might not be ideal for this. And I can see here that the rubber is very close. The switch is very close. So what you'll have, people call it like the machine gun effect. The kicker will come forward and then it will slam back, and that rubber rebound will close the switch again, and you'll get that happening.
Right.
So when this is the perfect time to check for that kind of stuff, instead of putting everything back together and then realizing, oh crap, I have to take it all back apart again. I'm gonna get in here and just use my switch adjuster. You should do this from the bottom, but this is a small adjustment I need to make. I'm going to just bend it back a teeny bit. And I've created a gap that's maybe 1 millimeter wide. Sorry, I don't... metric is a little bit easier for me to measure those small gaps, so it's small. But what you want to make sure is that it has enough of a gap to open and close, but you also want to make sure that the gap is small enough so a good glance will make it fire. Good slingshot action makes a game more fun and difficult. So one thing you can do, again, it's like I didn't take pictures when I took this apart, but I wanted to reinforce, like, there's things you can do to remember where things go without needing to take pictures. This game uses a lot of like metal sleeves. It also uses posts. But you can see around where a lot of these posts went, like if we could get a zoom in on that, if it zooms in far enough, you can see a witness mark right here of where this wide bottom post used to go. So you know, obviously, right, okay, I gotta put a post here. If you see the witness marks where the metal posts go, they're a lot smaller. So you can look and see, you know, what was there without needing to have a photo, if you forgot to take one or whatnot. Like, especially if you got a game and you don't know, you got it taken apart, you adopted someone's project or something like that, and you didn't have any posts on there, how can you tell where things are supposed to go, right? This is the piece of plastic that goes on top of this lane right here. And since I had been putting some incorrect screws on with those studs, I wanted to come in here and check. Okay, so, you know, do we need a studded screw on top of this lane guide right here? If we lay the plastic in place, that'll tell us what hardware we need.
Oh, you guys love that ragtime music. All right, we're going to do an audio check. How do I sound?
You sound great.
Oh, thanks. How does Kyle sound? Kyle, how are you doing today?
I'm breathing. I'm conscious. I'm hydrated. And I'm ready to talk pinball. So good, I think.
Do I sound a lot louder than Kyle? Kyle is only on the left side. What is that? That's a new one. Huh. It's every every week. It's something new.
There was no audio issue last week, though. That was pretty cool.
Kyle, why are you mono?
Well, I don't know. Hold on. Oh, maybe because one of the plugs wasn't pushed in all the way on the receiver. How about now? Am I in full obnoxious stereo?
Yeah.
Great.
I think that fixed it.
I'm sorry, everyone that has to hear my stereo voice now. Did we put the no enter sign up?
Okay. All right, we're going to bring Kyle up. Boy, quiet.
See how crazy my hair looks today. Hello, everybody.
Oops. I love this ragtime music. Is it just me?
The only person that can hear the music?
Oh. Well, everyone else can hear.
I have no idea what's going
on. Oh no, I just hid you.
Like, good or bad? I can see my voice coming through on the level thing. Are these self-induced audio issues now?
Yes.
All right.
Okay, how does he sound now? Can you boost up a little bit on your mic, too?
Let's see. Yep, I can boost it up. I've got like one more ring to go on the little thingy.
Pretty good.
Looks okay, maybe. Yay, nay. Maybe, no.
Okay, I think we're good. I'm gonna start. We should start, right? Everyone wants to start?
Everyone wants to watch. Hello. I'm dreaming about haircuts now. I'm so excited to get a haircut. I'm telling that to like two people that have really long hair.
Oh, you want to see how long my hair is right now?
I wish my hair was that glorious.
Longer than my wingspan. I have to put it in front so I don't sit on it.
Amazing.
Sheesh.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to...
Now I have an echo. What is this?
Oh, my gosh.
I didn't even do anything. So, Kyle, what else did you change on your end?
I clicked up twice on my microphone. Did you mess with...
okay.
Did you mess with the noise gate?
Me. Are you wearing your earpiece?
No, we can't do that, remember?
I can turn it down. I turned it down. How about now?
Okay. Hello, everybody. Do I have an echo? No, I think it's good.
It's good? Okay, I turned you down a little bit on the computer also.
Perfect. Oh, yay. Welcome, everybody, to Pintech Live, your favorite Thursday pinball repair show. It's gotta be. It's absolutely gotta be.
Yeah, it might be the only one. Maybe.
So today you can see Kyle is all nicely set up on his quote-unquote workbench, and he's hiding something from us, but we see his legs, so we can actually see his reveal. We're going to be recapping a System 11 power supply. This is our kind of our intro to board work per se. We might start getting into some more complex episodes after this, so
yeah.
Hang in there with me. I am total noob, so you might see my eyes cross a little. And then just a reminder, again, we have our awesome... Oh, I always do that backwards. Our 24-hour free shipping link in the comments for our Pintech followers. This is good for domestic ground shipping for orders over $99.
Let's see. Yeah, so... buy some parts, get some inspiration, and do some work on your own game this week.
Yeah, so as you're learning, you know, then start adding stuff to your cart. And you can see our little slideshow, too. Why? I'm weird. What's over there.
Weird? I'm weird? I
have all the capacitors and little doodads like that that we're working on today. Kyle's going to tell you the more educated technical terms.
Sure, yeah. I'll try.
Oh, is shipping regardless of size? Can we ship free ground domestic shipping for playfields and rotisseries?
Yeah, we can.
Yeah, try it.
Yeah, that stuff's fine. It's like if you come and you want to buy like 90 sets of pinball legs, well, we might have to talk a little bit, but playfields, absolutely.
PinDaddy41 on Twitch said, just because it's the only Thursday repair show doesn't mean that it isn't still the best.
Aww. That warms diodes, my little heart.
Yes. We have lots of diodes going on today. So, Kyle, give us a little brief run through of what we're going to be looking at today.
I'm going to keep hitting my head on this camera that's right in front of my forehead. That's what I'm going to keep doing. No, we're gonna do some real basic like introduction board work. This is like, I think last time we touched a board, we were doing headers on a light board or something like that, maybe on Bride of Pinbot. That's like a kindergarten level board repair. That's super easy, real simple stuff. This is like third or fourth grade. It's pretty simple. We're still going like chronologically. But what we're gonna be doing is replacing some capacitors in what is the 5-volt circuit, the entire circuit that, you know, comes from being one voltage, gets turned into 5, and then goes and powers your game. And that is the most important circuit that comes out of this power supply. Without that voltage, nothing works. So, well, you have GI, but that's about it. But your program won't run, your computer won't run, and that's the most important thing to get solid. So, yeah. We've got some tools here that are going to be a little different than last time. Friend of the show, Steve Bertok let me borrow his solder sucker, or a desoldering iron. This is my favorite. I had one of these, but I do not have it anymore, and I need to buy another. It's a Hakko 301. It's kind of the spiritual successor to the Hakko 808, or whatever the old version of this was. It's a really, really nice desoldering iron. What a desoldering iron is a heating element with a tip with a hollow shaft. So you can activate a vacuum pump that will suck all of the molten solder away. This is the gentlest way to remove solder from a circuit board or anything, really, where you wouldn't need to use like a manual solder sucker. I like it. It's quick, it's easy, and it's very safe. I am also using my stationary Hakko 888D instead of like my normal iron. I would normally do this with my normal iron, but I figure I'd set this up like my normal workbench with, you know, bench equipment.
So, I like how all your tools match.
Oh yeah, yeah. I'm a I'm a fan of matching, but Hakko makes really good products. I really like their soldering irons. They're pretty tough. I've been using them for a while without issue. Weller also makes another fine soldering iron. You know, it's just it's nice to have things match sometimes.
We have a question from Muff Cole on Twitch asking, how do you know when to replace a capacitor? Is there any tests that you can do?
You replace capacitors when they have exploded and leaked all of their nasty magical electrolytic juice all over the place, or as a precaution. Some systems you want to do this on more than others. Honestly, there are really only three or four I would change on this power supply. They haven't gone bad, but I wanted to do an introduction to board work. I've been wanting to do this on this show for a while. So generally, I will try to replace suspect capacitors before they become a problem. But when they blow up, it's pretty apparent. They leave like a very shiny residue all over the board, or they get bulged out on one end.
Do we have an example we can show of what it looks like?
I should have looked a little harder, but I didn't think about finding an example. If I do find a bad board, we can go over that, the signs of those things. But this is, what is it called when you do something? This is preventative surgery instead of reactional surgery. We're going to do some things to keep this original, amazing, wonderful power supply running for a while. So.
Awesome. Yeah, so look for visibly swelling.
Yeah, visible swelling, and sometimes, especially under, this is called a radial capacitor. Both leads kind of come out the bottom. You'll see sometimes, sometimes on circuit boards, when a radial capacitor is leaking, you'll see shiny liquid coming out from here, and that can be corrosive. Not like, you know, battery corrosive, but it can eat through traces and do damage to things. So, you know, the magic juice inside the capacitor needs to stay there. If it leaks out, it causes problems. So, yeah.
So if it starts to leak out and I don't get to my soldering iron and stuff to replace it, what's the best way to clean it?
You can't, I mean.
Or like, you know.
You need to replace it.
It leaks out. I need to replace it. I pull off the bad one, and there's still residue.
Yep.
Do I
okay.
just wipe it down with a cloth?
No, I like to use I don't have any. Screwed. I wish we had an electronics store around here I could buy some from, but there's something called flux remover, which is it will remove this sticky, nasty stuff called flux that we are going to use to get the solder to melt and be cooperative. A flux remover will take that stuff off. Spray a little bit of that and like a clean or a dirty toothbrush. That's what I used to clean the board off. Sometimes I also had like a can of isopropyl alcohol that was an aerosol that I can't find that would also kind of do the same thing. So, but you know, if a capacitor leaks like that, you really need to inspect the board and make sure that circuit isn't damaged. There are three kinds of capacitors in pinball. These ones that come in cans like this, this is what we'd call an electrolytic capacitor. It's got like layers of metal with like, and the electrolytic fluid, the juice that makes capacitance happen. I'm not an engineer, I'm not going to try to explain it. There are ceramic capacitors, which are these guys here that kind of look like little poker chips with legs or something. And then there's another capacitor that you'll see sometimes that's called a tantalum capacitor. I don't know what that material, I mean, it's tantalum. I don't know how it works, but that's if you remember on The Bride of Pinbot when Steve and I were working on that 3 or 4 weeks ago, that's the capacitor that burst into flames and sparks when we tried turning the game on. So each capacitor kind of has its own fail condition. Like these will balloon out and become bad or leak. Tantalum capacitors explode into a lot of magic smoke, and ceramic capacitors, they just kind of go bad. But they don't go bad often enough, which is why we're not going to change them on this power supply. We are not going to change a lot of capacitors on this power supply. We won't be changing these two capacitors here, which are filter capacitors for the high voltage system. The reason we won't change these things is they don't generally fail. And if they fail, the worst that's going to happen is we are going to have something goofy going on with the display. It's not going to put the game out of action, per se. So most of my time, it's not worth it to replace these things. Especially on certain games that use certain size capacitors. On Bally games like my Viking and my Xenon, those things, are the high voltage system, those capacitors are rated up to like 350 volts, and that's a very expensive capacitor. So instead of directing a customer's money towards a part that isn't necessarily going to fail, and again, the worst thing that would happen was their displays would flicker, you know, I'm going to skip that. I'm going to try to make the core of the game reliable. This capacitor right here is a filter capacitor for the solenoids, and this is another low failure rate item. I have the capacitor. We could change it, but this doesn't go bad that often. This capacitor here, this large one, this is the filter. What's up?
It's a big one.
It's a big one. This is the filter capacitor for the 5-volt circuit. Now, I always change these on Bally power supplies. Now, again, this is why the Bally ones are always going bad. Williams did not pay, what would I call it? They didn't go with like the lowest bidder on this part. This is like a really good part. This capacitor is likely still good. We sell a replacement capacitor, 18,000 microfarad at 25 volts. But this is like $20-something. It's very expensive for a capacitor. They don't go bad often. The only reason I'm going to change it is we have this 18,000 microfarad capacitor at 35 volts. That is what's called a snap. So what you see here is this is an axial capacitor. It's got one lead coming out of each side, like an axle, right? Imagine like Fred Flintstone's car. That's the axle, right? Then you've got.
Let me just zoom out a little bit. Yeah.
And then you've got.
Was all up and down, and up and down. This is good.
You've got your radial capacitor, which has leads coming out of the same side. So, in a pinch, you can absolutely replace a axial capacitor with a radial. So, this is a cheaper option. It's a more modern design. Axial capacitors kind of aren't used often anymore. I mean, a lot of these components aren't used since everything is going to something called surface mount now. But I'll show you how we can cleanly and neatly use an alternative if we can't get this. And I will probably keep this capacitor just in case I ever need it again. I even brought a fancy tool that I found in the office that is a capacitor meter. We can use it to test the capacitance of our capacitors. So it'll be kind of fun to see how good this thing still is after 30 whatever years. So.
Very cool. A few things from the chat.
Yes.
Bad Out of Hell by Meatloaf
says, welcome back.
Is there any way to test capacitance with a DMM?
No. You can test for some other things, but like normally what I'd use a multimeter for when I'm checking a big capacitor like that is checking for the AC ripple. But you can't really do that on a digital multimeter because they do not respond fast enough. The guy I used to work for showed me on his, he had an analog meter, and I really want one of these things, a Simpson analog meter. And it has an analog needle that goes back and forth. And you can actually see, they're so responsive, you can watch the ripple of the influx of power and power leaving the capacitor, making a bit of a mess. You could use an oscilloscope, which would be the most obnoxious, expensive digital multimeter you could have to try to do that. Capacitors are very cheap. Replace them. It's like, it's not worth diving into a lot of this stuff. You know, if you suspect it's bad, if you're going to be in there, just replace it. They don't cost much. Unless you have like some weird capacitor that costs $20 because it's super obsolete.
So, what's an LCR meter?
I have no idea.
Kevin Moore says you need an LCR meter to check caps.
Yeah, it's something special, but that's kind of like what this thing does. It's just a capacitance checker. This will latch on to a capacitor and show and test it. Like what? This is a 100 microfarad capacitor. And or let's use something smaller that might be a little more fun. This is a, well, I guess this is another 100 microfarad capacitor, whatever. We'll hook up the black lead to the negative side, the red lead to the positive side. Capacitors are, polarized, so you do need to put them in the right way, but we'll go over that. This has 91 microfarads of capacitance. I do not know how accurate this thing is, but it's close enough to, it's within 10% of its actual value. So, anyways.
This is intense. You said this is third grade?
This is like third grade level soldering. You really don't need, you don't need to know most of this stuff. I'm just trying to expand, you know, the basic level of what these things are. A capacitor in a circuit like this, it's kind of like a, think of it as like a water tower. It's going to keep like a good solid flow of juice to the intended circuit, right? So, you know, you've got power coming in one way and essentially juice coming out the other side. It's kind of like a water tower. So if you have any flux or, you know, something crazy going on, it spikes in juice, this will allow the system to kind of normalize what's going on. That's like the most basic way to describe what these things do. Again, I'm not an engineer, so that's a very third grade way to explain this stuff.
I like the third grade way of explaining it. It helps out a lot.
It helps me too. I'm a very visual learner, so like when I was learning about electricity and such, visualizing it with the water method kind of helps a lot.
Nice. Well, before you get into it, just a few things from the chat.
Yes.
This was a little earlier. I had to scroll up. Mike P505 on Twitch says, I have one, a system 11 power supply that is only providing 100 plus volts.
Yeah.
Not 100 minus volts.
Yeah. The regulators for the high voltage, which runs the high voltage displays, the gas plasma displays, I think these are both obsolete now. So you can get a replacement. Look on PinWiki. There's a good write-up on how to do it. You have to get a different, these are the high voltage regulators here. You have to get another one and you have to like twist the legs or something like that. Like one leg goes to the same spot, but like the left leg needs to go to the right hole. The right hole needs to go to the left hole. You can do it safely. It's something you can absolutely do, but yeah. But read up on rebuilding the high voltage section. There's definitely multiple components you want to replace. There's some Zener diodes. I generally go through and I'll replace the Zener diodes, the regulators when they go bad. There's a lot of write up on it. I didn't prepare myself, so I don't want to say anything incorrectly today, so I won't go into it super hard. But
all right, well, let's get into the task at hand, which is recapping this.
Sure.
Recapacitating.
Hey Emoto, did you have this this diagram? Can you pull that up for people to see?
Yes, yeah. I can pull that up. Watch so, this. Bam.
In your manual, you do have some of the Maybe manuals have a layout of Bam. Each component. There you go. So this will show us where the components are on the board. A lot of times if you buy like a recapping kit or something like that, they're going to include every capacitor and sometimes they'll tell you where they go. But sometimes it's up to you in the schematic to read it. This board, the foil on this board does not say what each capacitor is called. So we can go through it two ways. We can go through with like information like this and be like, okay, on the schematic in this circuit, we need to change C7, this, and refer to this sheet, which you can see on the screen. The other way to do it, and this is how I'll generally do it when I'm in like a well-stocked shop with every capacitor I need, is we go through and remove each capacitor one at a time and replace it with the value that is corresponding, which is kind of what we'll do now. I do like having the sheet nearby just to double check things sometimes. since I don't do this like every day, all day anymore, I have to keep fresh, keep it all in my memory, but I don't want to make mistakes. So that's why I wanted to bring that sheet. The fire manual, for whatever reason, does not have the component layout. So yeah, I have my manual here. I've got my parts. I've got this. We're armed with knowledge.
You know what we need for an upgrade, which would be really cool? One of those tablets where you can draw on as a screen, and then you can put your schematic on there, and then you can kind of pen over what we're actually talking about.
That's kind of fun. That would be interesting, because it would be, it's hard to show this on camera. We tried to do that at one point, I think. And it's the print is small, and it's stained with all sorts of soda and nastiness.
Yeah, even so. With the... you know, the big screenshot, it's just like, okay, what are we?
Yeah, so, well.
Okay, so these are like the fuses. There's the board.
So,
it's
yeah.
It's basically exactly what the board is, and the numbers correlate to
what's going to show in the schematic. So, I'm going to bring this really close to the camera, put the big camera on the screen, and we can kind of look. And I'll just point a couple things out,
look
right?
Look at that. It's like coffee stained and.
Oh, yeah. No, this is a great manual. But okay, it's not going to come up. There's not enough light, sorry. But what it is in the schematic here, it shows me that C7 is a 100 microfarad capacitor that's rated for 25 volts. Now, we could sit here and we could look on the schematic, or the board itself, and we could try to find the 100 microfarad at 25 volt capacitor. But sometimes having that roadmap makes it easy, because I could use this sheet of paper here and say, okay, C7 is right there. Okay, that's C7, so that's the one we need to change. So there's a few different ways of going about this, and it just depends on your skill level, what you have, how you ordered your parts, whatever. So what I think we'll do is we will work, we'll just work from one side to the other. The capacitors we are changing for this job is, this is C8, C7, C9, C12, and C11, I think, is the filter capacitor, or C10. So yeah, we're going to work on that. C stands for capacitor. Fun fact.
Thank you for that.
R generally means resistor. What other things do we have here? A Q is kind of usually sometimes a transistor. Ds are diodes, but there's lots of flavors of diodes. So sometimes you need to learn how to read a symbol to tell if it's what kind of diode it is. Anyways, we're getting way snowballed out of hand here, so let's stick to the easy stuff. What we're going to do, I know that we are going to change this capacitor. This one is C8. What we can do is is this camera on here, the top one? Oh, it is.
It is.
So what we can do is we could check the position of the capacitor on the board and try to reaffirm where it goes on the back of the board. I can see these two spots here. Flip it over. Yeah, that's absolutely that capacitor, because the component below it is this relay. There's the relay. That's totally the capacitor. A little giveaway is there's a plus sign in the foil here that will tell us which side the positive lead of the capacitor needs to go to. So that's another way I can tell that's a capacitor. What we will do is take a little bit of our flux here. Just a teeny bit on the end of a really nasty screwdriver.
Toothbrush?
Yes. Toothbrush.
I was like, is that a screwdriver?
We could shape it into a toothbrush. Put a little bit of that onto the solder. That's going to help it melt super, 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 super easy. Most solder does have some flux in it, but we're going to work on removing solder instead of adding stuff right now. I have my solder sucker. It's sucking.
Wow.
Again, be careful. Work in a well-ventilated area when you're doing this. I am going to remove my breathing areas away from all the smoke that's coming off of this board. So what we're going to do here, let's see. Zoom in with that sucker. Let's see
angles. What
we can get here. I'll try to hold it outward.
We got the slow, epic zoom in.
Okay, so we've got these small, you know, the leads for this thing are small. So what we want to do, I'm going to kind of get in all goofy here because I kind of need to watch what's going on. We need to hold the soldering tip over and around the through hole.
and we are going to make sure we melt all the solder. The solder does sit on the back, and it does run up to the top of the board. So don't just apply your iron, suck, and then take it off. You're not going to thoroughly melt all the solder. Sometimes you do have to add solder to get these things to come undone. So we'll see what we can get. But I'm going to set this here, confirm that the solder is melting, and then suck. And as I am pulling the soldering, desoldering iron away, I'm going to keep the vacuum on. A big problem with this tool is when the tube gets clogged with hard solder. So keeping the suction going so it all enters the chamber is useful. We will get it on there. I can see it melting, pulling it away. That's a clean break. We'll do the same thing here.
Oh, Mitchell Reeder's here. Welcome.
What's up, man?
We missed you last week.
See how good that did? Came off super easy, and we have a good, clean hole. Now, you do want to do one thing. When you are removing capacitors. I like to do this one at a time. It's important to do this stuff one at a time for me because I like to be able to ensure and have like thorough accuracy about what I'm putting back in the board. Sometimes it is handy on these radial capacitors to notate which side the negative is. But thankfully, as we noticed on this board, there is a positive lead signal down here.
Can you zoom in on that?
Let's hyper zoom in. See if you can even see that plus sign.
It might take a second to find the focus.
There's a teeny, teeny plus sign on the upper hole here, kind of right next to my finger. You've got two bare holes.
No.
I'm watching. So you've got two holes, and then you've got a plus sign above there. Some boards make it easier. Williams did not make it super easy on this board, per se. So we removed a 47 microfarad capacitor that's rated at 63 volts. That is C8. I can find C8 on the schematic here. And it is 47 at 50. OK, so here's another thing about reading capacitors. The microfarad, that is basically, let's call that the size of the water tower. And kind of like fuses. When you get something that's rated at 250 volts, that means that is the highest voltage that that component can take. So this component here says that it is 63 microfarads at, how much was it? 63 volts. It's overrated. This is OK up to 63 volts. The part that I have is not that one. Is this one. I have 47 microfarads at 50 volts. So I know that in this circuit, we do not have that high of a voltage. The schematic does call or says that a 50-volt one is fine. If you took a 63-volt out, that's fine. If you want to replace it with a 63-volt, that's fine. I always recommend at least replacing it with what the schematic says. In these circuits, capacitance is important, but it is not, again, pinball electronics aren't like hypersensitive like avionics or some audio or medical equipment. Generally, as a rule of thumb, you can go up in capacitance, but don't go crazy, right? Like, this is 47 microfarads. Like, I could probably put a 50, I could probably put 100. Don't put 1,000. You know, it's like try to get it as close as possible. But sometimes if you need to fudge the numbers, do it at your own risk. But generally, as a rule of thumb, going up a little bit is OK. In capacitance, never go under and never underrate the voltage.
And if you do, what happens?
Bad things. If you put a capacitor that's rated for too low of a voltage into a circuit that runs a higher voltage, it will probably explode. If you put a capacitor in backwards, because they are polarized, there's a positive and a negative side, it will explode. If you put something in with a wacky capacitance, I don't know. That could change things. But again, I'm not an engineer. I trust these guys. They did it pretty good. So just don't do that.
Excuse me.
Don't find out yourself either. Just follow the rules.
All right, quick question from Bad Out of Hell. Since all these capacitors are pretty safe to touch, they're used to working on guitar amps.
Yeah.
And if you touch a filter cap there, you're dead.
Yes, so okay. So
it's not the same way for pinball, right?
No, because these voltages are a lot lower. There are, I mean, on the high voltage section here, I absolutely wouldn't want to be touching these things when they were on. But these high voltage capacitors are only 100 microfarads, so they will discharge rather quickly. On things like guitar amps, on working on like video game monitor chassis, on televisions and stuff like that, you have to discharge those capacitors. There is a lot of deadly kill-yourself voltage there. This stuff's pretty safe. In this circuit, again, the maximum we're working with on one side is 12 volts, the other side is 5 volts, and this has been unplugged from the pinball machine for a while. So this is safe to handle. This is a guide for doing a Williams power supply. If this was like recapping a electro home monitor from my baby Pac-Man, this would be very different. We would be taking a lot of other safety precautions. Or if we were recapping an amplifier, guitar amplifier, sound amplifier, or you know, stereo amplifier. Yeah, it's different. So yes, very, very good point. Thank you. I forgot to mention that. This is pinball related. So on this radial capacitor, maybe this blue one will show up. We've got two leads, a short one and a long one. Very, very, very often, the shorter one is the negative side. There is a very clear stripe here that has a negative symbol that is right next to the short lead. So we know that the short side is negative, long side is positive. We know that there is a plus mark here too. So we can tell the which way to put the capacitor in from the top of the board, as well as utilizing the positive mark on the back of the board. So we will install the longer lead, the positive side of the capacitor, facing the positive sign. And that way we polarize the capacitor correctly. This capacitor is a little bit smaller. That's another thing we should bring up. This is ancient technology in the terms of electronics, right? This is super old. This is old school also. Back in the 80s, this was probably the perfect form factor for a 47 microfarad, 63 volt capacitor. The new capacitor is a ton smaller. Manufacturing tolerances are different nowadays. I guess I could do it here. I'm sorry, cameraman Steve. with your mega zoom. If you do get something that's substantially smaller than what you took out, as long as the rating is okay, don't worry. This is 30-something year old. This is new. And the reason I bring that up is because the lead spacing, the wires that come out of the capacitor, are a bit narrower than the old component. So I really can't get this thing to sit down nice and flush with the board. I don't want to force the legs at a weird angle to maybe cause a weak point in the capacitor. So the capacitor will, let me look at the screen here. If you can see, it's kind of slightly floating off the board a teeny bit. I mean, there's a microscopic gap, maybe a millimeter, which is fine. Just make sure that you secure it tightly and we do not have any rocking going on. These are pretty light, and the pinball machine doesn't move often, so this is going to be OK. We will take our soldering iron, which is hot, with a nice clean tip. We will get some solder. Again, when handling this stuff, when handling circuit boards, when handling your solder, don't eat. Wash your hands. Don't touch your face. Think of this as like COVID-19. Don't touch it and then touch yourself. It's bad for you. We're going to apply our soldering iron tip to the foil, the actual pad, the component, and the solder. And we will bring all of three of those things together at one time. We're good on cameras. Does this need to move at all?
Maybe we can. I'm going to try to zoom in.
I could probably
do
it at a goofy angle, and the big camera could try to capture. I could lean it up against my toolbox, kind of. Can you get this zoom okay? Yeah, I think the big camera's got it, Emoto.
Yeah, it looks like it. Let's
see. So again, the thing is we want to bring the heat to both of the components at the same time and then add the solder. So we want to make sure the components are hot add the solder at the point of contact on both devices, and that will ensure a nice, smooth, solid, good connection. I will press this here, let it heat up, add a teeny bit of solder, let it flow through the hole, remove the soldering iron. We'll do the same thing for the other side. If you noticed, I didn't use very much solder at all. We are not trying to make blobs. We are trying to make it look like I was never here.
Okay. Oh, great. Oh, you almost got it. Yeah, right there is great.
Right there-ish. Sorry, it's kind of goofy.
Yeah, just stop moving it around so much.
Hey, no. That's what we're looking for, right? We don't have these giant mountains. They're a little bit taller than the factory stuff, but, you know, I think I did a pretty okay job there. So I'm going to call that good. This is a double-sided board. I think we mentioned that before, that some boards have traces on one side and traces on the other side. So as we can see, like, one end of that capacitor hits a trace on this side of the board. The other side is just like a floating pad. And that side has its own trace on this side of the board. And that's why you want to make sure you let the solder flow through the hole, go through the fillet, and create a good connection. I'm going to clip the leads. So I'm going to grab my flush cutter here. We're going to cut these very close to the solder mound, but not like cut into the meniscus of the solder. We don't want to break that because that could make a crummy connection. But we also don't want the lead sticking out super far from the back of the board because that could cause a short. So one down, a few more to go. I can take questions now.
Can I interject real quick?
Very much so.
Are those flaking traces nothing to worry about? I guess we're seeing some flaking traces.
Yeah, I mean, that's normal. It's just like whatever. I don't know what they cover these traces with, but they kind of bubble up sometimes. I'm trying to find a bad spot where I could kind of flake it away. Here's one. This is normal. It's fine. No. Actually, it's not flaking that bad at all. Don't worry about it. Okay, next capacitor is C7. So let's get this guy out. We're going to identify it. So let's see, I'm going to look here and I'm going to say it's pretty close to the relay, it's pretty close to the diode, it's really close to a fuse clip. Let's flip the board over. There's a fuse clip, there's the relay, there's a diode, and there's a little plus sign. That's our boy right there. Flip it over, double check. That's good. Add a teeny bit of flux here. Grab the solder sucker. Try to get the head of it around the capacitor lead, and that will ensure that it melts and sucks everything up. So we could do this with desoldering braid. I could do this with a solder sucker, like a manual vacuum one, but this ensures, like, safety. We're not going to ruin a pad. We're going to make sure we get all the solder since we have assisted vacuum and constant heat. It's just a really good way to do. I really recommend these if you're going to get into board work. They're expensive. It's an expensive tool, but it makes this a breeze.
Nice. Quick question for you.
Yo.
From Moff Cole. You know what Moff Cole stands for, by the way?
No.
Master a few, knowledge of even less.
Hey, that sounds like me.
Asked, can the solder iron be held long without damaging the board or capacitor?
Yes, but
thumb for that.
Yes, but don't try it. The goal is to kind of get in there quick and do the job right without hanging around longer than necessary. You can damage things, but that's something that comes with experience, is kind of the feel. And, you know, again, soldering kind of takes almost all your senses except for taste and smell. But watching the solder, you know, watch it melt. You'll notice that when the solder starts to kind of pile up onto the pad, and then you'll notice it kind of sinks a teeny bit as it flows through the board. Once you see the solder kind of, the solder blob shrink a teeny bit, you know that you've kind of made that decent connection. But that also depends on how hot your soldering iron is, what kind of solder you're using. It really takes getting in tune with your equipment or something like that, right? Like, get used to what you're using. But it's a practice. I've been doing this for a while, and I've kind of, you know, gotten used to what I'm using. So That's why I always suggest like practicing on something that it might be a bad circuit board or something that you have laying around.
Right.
You know, if your power supply caught on fire or something and you've replaced it, and you think you know that it's like a write-off, or you have a very badly acid-damaged computer, use that as a practice tool. Don't throw it away.
Yeah, don't practice on your games, right?
Yeah, if you need to practice, don't practice on your only copy of what you're trying to do.
Okay.
And don't drink that soda on the table, because you reminded everyone not to eat and drink, and yet you have a nice can right there.
So I found that last week, my voice, my vocal cords were not like absolutely dead for 2 days if I drank a little water while I was on camera. So I will be enjoying that wash my hands.
Don't do it while you're soldering, because that goes against the rules. Thank you, Joe Holt, for pointing that out.
Don't let me break my own rules. Thank you. Okay, so we're going to replace this capacitor. This capacitor, again, is marked with a negative. It has a shorter lead on the negative side. I see a plus sign, so I'm not going to put the negative sign through the plus sign. I took out a 100 microfarad capacitor rated for 25 volts. The size is comparable, but kind of different. Stick that in here through the through holes, which are beautiful. If this circuit board was damaged, or if this circuit board had, if this had like a corrosive electrolytic juice on it, this process would be a little more arduous. We would need to clean those sorts of things. It dulls the shiny pads, and if the solder wants to go to something that is shiny, has flux on it, and is hot. So sometimes when those electrolytic juices get out, the pads will become discolored, and it will be very difficult to get the solder to stick or flow through. If these were damaged, we would need to get in with like the fiberglass pen that I use and clean, or we go in with the chemical, try to remove the crap, try to clean the surface once the goopy junk has been removed, and then we would be applying flux to both sides of the hole and then soldering to ensure we did it correctly. Working on damaged circuit boards is a whole other skill set that needs to be learned on top of doing this sort of stuff. So if you do end up, you're like, hey, I think I can do this, I want to tackle this, be wary if it's damaged. At that point, it might be worth it to send it to a professional. Find a professional in your area and see if you can watch, see if you can learn something.
Yeah, and speaking of which, if you don't know a professional pinball technician in your area, we've been keeping a database of pinball technicians, so you can shoot us an email at, what would be the best email for that? sales@marcopinball.com, and we can go through our database and try to match someone up with you. And if you are a pinball technician out there, which I know a lot of you are in our chat, and you're not in our database yet, shoot us an email so we can add you, please.
Is that Google Sheet still open? Could they possibly go and look for that Google Sheet?
Yes, the Google Sheet is still there. Actually, I can copy and paste it into the chat.
I can see a good connection here, too. I've got solder that came up from the bottom and is making a connection on this trace. So another job okayly done. Get rid of these leads. Okay, there's another one. Okay, so here's one that I kind of goofed up on purpose. On some boards, they, component availability varies. And axial capacitors might be like super cheap one day because a boat from Thailand or Vietnam, wherever these things are made, opened up and, these are like 15 cents cheaper than the radial version. Sometimes on certain circuit boards, they do lay out the provisions to do both styles. So here's a capacitor right here. We've got the positive lead where my finger is. The negative lead goes to where my finger is now. But you can also see there's another hole here that shares the same trace. So if we look here at the top, we can see where this radial capacitor is attached. But we can see that hole right here. So in this case, we could easily use a axial capacitor as opposed to a radial. So I got this just to show that you can do that. Anyways,
Not all boards are like that. In this case, I knew it was like that, so I got that to show off. Anyways, let's give that a shot. Okay, on axial capacitors. Actually, let's desolder it, and then I'll start blabbing again. This is a much fatter trace here. When you are working with a trace that is significantly larger than the small guys we've been working with, you know, here and... here and here. Sometimes working with these bigger traces, it will take longer to heat the solder blob up because this is going to absorb a lot of the heat radiating from your soldering iron. So when you are working on a big fat trace like that, you need to ensure that everything's melted. I keep these soldering irons pretty toasty because I know I can work relatively quick. You probably should learn to work with your iron as hot as you're comfortable working. Makes things easier. You can kind of hear with this iron too, you can hear it suck the solder up, and then you can kind of hear it kind of going like whistling a little bit, like little when it's broken that connection, and you can hear the air sneaking in from the other side of the trace through. So again, use all your senses when you're doing this kind of work. This one, I'm gonna do facing me just because I need to watch. There we go. That guy wants to fall right out.
So I noticed you kind of like jiggle the gun around. Is that kind of help wiggle it off?
When I jiggle the desoldering iron around, what it's doing is, since the iron is kind of the hole for the suction is around the one of these leads on the capacitor, when I'm jiggling it, is this will move the capacitor slightly and allow it to suck all the residual solder that might be stuck between one side that doesn't have a gap or not, you know what I mean? So using a little motion like that ensures you suck all of the solder out.
Cool.
So since we are going to install a axial capacitor, I will add
a... Oh yeah, everyone is loving your Steve Bertok desoldering iron. Can you tell us again what brand it is and model?
Yeah, one sec. It's a Hakko 301, I think. Yeah, FR301. It's amazing. If you're going to be doing board work, you really need one of these things.
Nice.
Okay. Let's see here. There's a lot of holes for this capacitor. So we know that the one here, the negative side goes away from the plus, but there are three holes. And what that tells me is they probably drilled this foil to accommodate a capacitor with varying lead sizes. So we need to make sure that when we install our axial guy here, that we are not connecting it from negative to negative. We need to make sure the positive side of the capacitor goes to the positive hole. Does that come through? Does that make sense? There's your positive hole, which is set. And then we've got three different negative holes. We've got axial hole here. And we've got like fat radial connection, skinnier radial connection, and then positive. You see the throw of that capacitor there. So make sure you do it right. On axial capacitors, we don't have the luxury of having one side being shorter, a lead being shorter than the other. I mean, maybe actually, but I don't think so. But there's another way to tell. The banded side, you see, maybe this camera will show it better. You kind of see how there's a, you see how there's kind of a, like a an indentation around the top of the can on this guy here, sort of?
It's just so blown out. Oh, you're talking about the...
At yes. The top of the can, you can kind of see an indent okay. there. That sure. indicates the positive side of a axial capacitor. So we have a, sometimes on these capacitors, you'll have a, you'll have these negative arrows, but there'll actually be an arrow pointing towards one way, and this side indicates the positive side. When in doubt, or here, actually, there's an example of that right here. On the small camera in the corner, you could see the negative with a little arrow facing away from that indentation. This is why it's good to remove these things one. with the plus on the foil. So try to keep that in mind.
Ned Reamer gave us an awesome reminder that we should show the cleaning procedure for the desoldering station before it gets put away.
Yeah. Like I said, the most important thing that I've found with these things is to ensure that you suction like after you've sucked everything out. So don't give the solder time to like kind of get stuck halfway through the tube. If you keep pulling as you're pulling it away, that ensures all the hot solder continues into the solder chamber. But yes, we will do that. There is a special tool they come with to do that. Just for cleanliness' sake, I'm going to close the two holes on the back of this board that we are not using. This is me just being anal, but I'm going to do it because it makes me happy. We will apply some heat and just add a teeny bit of solder so it's not an open hole. Do we need to do this? No. Is it going to change anything in the circuit? No. It just makes me happy. Okay. We are going to kind of bend these leads. I usually do this with diodes so they don't look goofy, but we'll kind of do it with this too. Get a pair of pliers and give yourself like a...
Whoa.
What?
Kyle, stop barking.
I'm not barking. Oh. Sorry, I thought the camera froze. I thought you were like, whoa, something weird happened. Who was that, Emoto? Which one of the 10,000 dogs that you say you have?
Oh, 10,000 of them. The Pokemon, probably, I think. Gotta catch them later.
Gotta catch them later, Pokemon. Okay, so we've kind of bent these things to a bit where hopefully they are going to fit.
Can you bring your...
Wow. That actually worked out perfect.
Some, so we can see it with the overhead camera. Okay. Well, yeah.
The lighting is weird in here. Sorry, everybody. To like get all the cameras looking good, we have to turn the overhead lights out, and we're kind of stuck with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 lights.
I have small lights.
What I'm doing here is I'm just slightly bending the leads of the capacitor away so I can work with the board upside down, and the capacitor won't fall out. Again, when you're doing these things, try to make it look factory. Keep the capacitor nice and tight up against the board. Yeah, I don't know, just looks better. Like I keep saying, it's like, just try to make it look like you were never here. We'll just try to make it look factory. There is a fine line between adding too little solder and having just enough solder. If you have like a really thin puddle holding the solder onto the back of the board here, that's a likelihood of that you could have a bad connection. So what you're trying to get are like teeny little volcanoes. That actually looks pretty good. The goal is to have a bit of solder kind of coming up to a very small point on either side of the lead. If it's too flat, that might not be enough solder. If it's like a giant bulb, there's less likely that you've made like a good heat connection. But if you have like a nice little volcano that kind of comes up at a slight angle, good job. All right.
Can capacitors be optional? Did I pronounce that right again? My bad. I have a getaway and the Triac driver board has a spot for a C2 capacitor, but no capacitor.
Yeah. Sometimes they can be. I'm not an engineer and I don't know why they do that, but sometimes different boards will be utilized for different things, and in some applications a capacitor is necessary. In that application, the engineers deemed it was not. So I wouldn't mess with it. Keep it the way that you found it. But yeah, you'll notice that sometimes boards aren't 100% stuffed for certain things. Sometimes you'll find, like even on this board, we do have some open holes here. Those could be used for components that have a different design. Maybe on a shuffle alley, they use different components here. This power supply remained almost unchanged from like System 7 days until system 11 times. Like there are some differences, but Some of those things might be, you know, why we are lacking some stuffed components here. Okay, let's move on to this capacitor here, which is another radial
Everyone
one.
Everyone wants that desoldering tool. Yeah, DeWisp, thanks for joining us again. He said Marco should carry the component lead benders.
So I think
posted a cool link of one.
I think we have. Maybe we don't. I know that we have a wire form bending tool that you can use almost the same, but
I'm gonna send this to you.
If you're really lucky and you buy components from a like a certain like parts house, sometimes they send you some as freebies. I know DigiKey does that sometimes. The nice thing about the flux and using flux is it just makes the solder melt immediately. The capacitor fell out.
The elusive ninja is back asking about the bridge rectifiers.
Yes, okay. So I really wanted to do that today, but Emoto shot you down.
Don't blame this on your producers. I don't think we will have time to do that yet.
Yeah.
Elusive ninja, we are recapping the system 11 power supply, but let's see where we get, you know, I mean, we're already an hour in.
Oh, wow. Really? Jeez. Yeah, we'll do that. We'll do that. I looked up that mod and I totally forgot about that. But yeah, we will do that on this fire because I think it was only a couple games after this that Williams started fusing the input side of the rectifiers. So what that mod is sometimes the bridge rectifiers that will turn the AC into DC for what like solenoid voltage and feature lamps or something. I don't remember. When the bridge rectifier shorts, like in theory, the line fuse should blow. There's enough draw and it will blow, but I guess some people have had this issue over the years where it doesn't blow and it catches on fire. So it's a good mod. We will absolutely do it. I don't want fire to fire itself.
Yes.
I could have made that pun way better.
That would be way too realistic. So let's... save that for CGI and
if,
practical.
If MGM Studios in here, he might have a really good pun where I was lacking something there. Okay, so I removed a 330 microfarad capacitor that was rated at 10 volts. I am installing a 330 microfarad capacitor rated for 16 volts. I can see the positive side here. I'm going to insert the capacitor the correct way.
Can you do it in the overhead camera?
Yeah, sorry. So again, these are all these capacitors we're replacing are part of the 5-volt circuit. If you weren't here when I was kind of explaining what was going on, the reason we're changing these is because if any of these 30-something-year-old components that will fail eventually do fail, you will lose your 5 volts and the game will not run. These are wear items. Capacitors dry up. The magical juice inside that makes the capacitance happen does lose its efficiency, and you can solve lots of issues with by replacing the dried up caps. A lot of times you'll notice that on sound. You'll recap your soundboard and your sound will sound clearer and less scratchy. And that's why we are doing this. They are a capacitor. I mean, you could. There's two kinds of components, I guess, on a circuit board. You've got passive and active components. So you have passive things that like just do their job, like a resistor, or arguably a diode or a capacitor. They get voltage and they do something. And then you have active things like transistors that drive things and like might change states. Blah blah blah. Generally, passive components do not go bad. Except for capacitors. Like, you don't have a resistor that just kind of, oh, you do have resistors that kind of decide they stop working at some point, but that's caused by so many things. But a resistor won't go bad just by sitting around. A capacitor will. Because an electrolytic capacitor will, the ones that are in the cans that are filled with a fluid. Okay, now we get to the big boy. And this is one that we are going to do something fancy on. This is our 12-volt filter cap. This filters the this filters the incoming 12 volts. So, on a lot of systems, especially Bally, old Bally games, prior to 6803. So everything from Freedom to Cybernaut uses a power driver board that has a capacitor that is notorious for going bad. When it degrades in quality, it will cause instances where the 12 volts will become inconsistent, which will not allow your 5 volt regulator to do its job, which will cause crashing. It will cause the game to not power up in instances. So that's like a no-brainer. You have to do that on that system. That's the first thing you do when you're working on a Bally game. This capacitor doesn't go bad, but we are going to change it so I can show you how you would install a radial style capacitor in the place of an axial capacitor. We need a zip tie, some wire, and the incorrect correct capacitor. I'm going to snip it. I'm going to snip it.
Asked, will it cause extra free games?
Unfortunately, not. It will cause extra sadness because you can't play your game. It will cause infinite sadness. I'm still looking forward to doing a Bally game. All my Bally games are work, except for, well, my Seawitch doesn't work, but I also don't have all of the Seawitch. So I'm trying to find a crummy Bally game that we can work on. If anyone is in the North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia area and wants to bring a game over for me to work on, do it. Okay, this is a wide capacitor. We can see that the ground side attaches to this big fat ground trace here. We can see that on both sides. And if we just kind of follow a straight plane, we can see that's most likely the other side. There's a positive tip to it. Let's flip it over. Yeah, it's kind of next to these three unstuffed components there. I can see those here. We've got our guy. Brush on some flux. Brush on more flux. I hope you guys are learning something. I'm sorry if I'm talking too fast. I'm actively, like consciously, trying to talk slower. I only drank one cup of coffee today to try to make that happen.
I think you said that you were going to try to talk slower, and then therefore you started talking faster than you've ever talked before. And wow. Our blue camera keeps dying, which is interesting.
Really?
Oh, it's back. Strange.
Huh. Well, hopefully we can fit more of those nice cameras in our budget soon.
Yeah, we need to upgrade it. Oh, man.
You need to get a fan in here, too. Hey, look at that. We did it so good, this thing fell out. Okay, so let's check this capacitor. This is the whole reason I brought this capacitance meter, is to see if this thing's bad. Normally, I wouldn't ever save anything. It's like ridiculous. This is like the dumbest penny-pinching thing. Like, don't do it. Just buy new stuff. But when the correct piece is like $25, and you should always use the correct piece, you know, sometimes if these things are still good, yeah, keep it around. But mark it. Always mark something that you've removed from a game so you can remember what you did with it. I have that problem a lot. But in this case, again, this is a much cheaper. I think this was like $12 or $15. It's a lot cheaper than a $25 component. So this is a good substitute for this job. If you do a little bit of extra footwork, we're going to turn this sucker on. Let's see what happens. I'm very hopeful. But this is also kind of just to prove to you guys. What's up?
Yeah, the Elusive Ninja brought up, Marco should have shop kits. Various fuses, rubbers, plastics, etc. Not game specific, but general shop use.
We do have
been talking about kind of putting together just like general kits.
We do. I mean, we have a fuse kit. We have like a general resistor kit. I think we have a general capacitor kit.
But I think like all together, like kind of like the tool bag.
A mega kit. Tool bag thing. Yeah, we could look into that. But we do have that stuff. Take a look. We don't sell tons of them, but it's a handy kit to have. Especially, like I keep telling everyone too, the assorted rubber kit. If you have more than one game, you absolutely want to buy something like that. Super handy. This capacitor is testing at 16,808 microfarads. So this is still a good capacitor.
Nice.
Will I ever use this? Probably not. Am I going to keep it around? Why not? You know, who knows when it's going to come in handy. I'm going to put
capacitor kits for power supplies?
We have some for certain games,
for
especially the Bally games. But here's the thing: is not sometimes every game might use a different like component layout. So we don't want to make a kit that is going to have everything fine for like Pimbot and Millionaire, but oh crap, it doesn't work in Fire or F14 or anything after that. So, you know, yeah, it's nice. That's something to look into. But we've got a lot of cool products coming in right now. I'd love to work on all that small stuff, but I'm really proud that all of our roller games parts just came in. So if you have a roller games and you want to upgrade your diverter, got new stuff. We're working on it.
And that'll be on the front page too.
I think I'm so proud of it that I am going to put it on the front page. And that means we get to work on roller games soon. Like everything, we have everything back. I've got a new ramp, I've got new parts. We could totally put that game back together. And that'll be fun. It'll be like Pintech coming home or something. All right, so this capacitor looks a little different. Is blue cam working? This one looks a little different than the others. This one doesn't have wire leads coming out the top or bottom, whatever you want to call it. This is called a snap capacitor. These are designed to be like kind of snapped into a board and then soldered in. But we can use it safely by making some wire leads, which we will use some wire for. It is very clearly marked with the negative side here. So we are going to take our black wire, which in lots and lots and lots of applications represents ground. I'm going to strip that wire a teeny bit, twist the leads up. We're going to tin the wire. That was something we did a long time ago, but what tinning is adding a bit of solder to the bit of the wire that you are going to attach to something. I'm going to apply the tinned soldering iron tip to the wire, apply the solder to the other end of the wire, and we've got a tinned wire there. The next thing I'm going to do is kind of do the same thing on the capacitor. Is this in view at all? There we go. Tin the tip of the iron again. I'm going to apply that to the lead of the cap. Put a teeny bit there. This is always awkward. I'm going to try to get these guys to stick together by, again, joining the two things we want to solder together to the heat and then applying them together. This takes a steady hand because I didn't set it up for success. whenever I do something like this, I always like to give it a stress test too. So I'm going to yank it. Looks good. I'm happy with that. We'll do the same thing with the red wire here, which in a lot of applications represents something hot or positive. When you start learning wiring harnesses, you'll see that some wires will change color. When something's like unregulated 12 volts, which is like 12 volts straight off of a 12 volts straight off of the transformer and the rectifier, that'll be one color. But once you have regulated 12 volts, something that generally goes through a filter capacitor and a 12 volt regulator chip or just a regulator itself, they'll become a different color. It's not something you really need to know because you can get all that information from your schematic. Tin that wire. Again, this is something like, everyone's like, wait, but Kyle, aren't you like Mr. Factory? And like everything needs to be correct and the same way it was 35 years ago. It's like, yeah, but if we are to do something like this, we can make it look good. So I like to go the extra step to make something look good. And like it could be factory, or at least acceptable. You always want to remember it's like, what's the next guy going to think? Do you want to make the next guy like curse and get angry when he starts working on the game you worked on last? No. Think about me if I ever have to work on a game. It's like, do you want Kyle to get all pissed off? No.
Oh, it's not a good view.
Damn it. This is where I need to get my head close and my fingers burnt.
Switch back.
All right, seems like my hands are a little steady. We can kind of do the same thing. Give it a stress test, wiggle it. It's not coming off. It'll never be under that much stress in actuality. So we're all good. So what we're going to do is we are going to, which camera is working right now? This one? Both of them. We're going to mount this capacitor this way. We can see the positive lead is here. We are going to shorten this wire significantly and solder it to the board. We are going to use the hole in the board to mount it with a zip tie, and we are going to run our black lead nicely and off the board, zip tie it to the capacitor, and install it through the other hole where the negative side of the capacitor goes. For style points, generally I do like to install the capacitors with their information upwards, so you can see what type of capacitor and what its specifications are. You know, if you installed it upside down, it makes it a little more difficult to find that information. So we'll make it easy
it's
on the next
guy. It's very kind of you. Elusive Ninja brought up, I don't know, maybe it's a stereotype, but he said arcade techs versus pinball techs. Those arcade guys never think of the next guy. I think it's just Kyle that always thinks of the next person that will have the game.
Yeah, well,
it's nice. It's very considerate.
There's a lot of people out there that can work on games, but I want to be an exemplary version of that guy, right? I want my work to show how good it is, so I don't have to tell someone, yeah, I'm qualified, right? If someone was to look at one of my games or something like, wow, that looks like it was done pretty good. It's like, yep, that's kind of how I treat everyone's game, right? We don't rush through things just because it's not yours or, you know, it's always been pushed into my head to do things like the right way, do it well.
You're definitely really good at instilling great etiquette, pinball repair etiquette.
Great. Now I just need a life coach to tell me to stop being lazy and stop procrastinating. So can someone in the chat like help me with that?
NetReamer, where are you?
That's cool. Yeah, NetReamer, teach me to be a better human.
Oh, we got an MGM Studios pun. We've been waiting for this.
Yes.
We've been waiting an hour and 15 minutes for this. He says, can Kyle wear a cap when he recaps the recap lesson?
Are there any hats in here? I have my super cool the captain's hat I got from the Houston Arcade Expo last year. That's my favorite hat.
Oh yeah, IndiePins is still bummed that the NVRAM for the machine is still out of stock.
Wait, what's up?
The NVRAM, for which machine? The machine or just a pinball machine? IndiePins, which?
Yeah, I think our Ramtron is not in stock right now. We have the AnyPin NVRAMs currently, which are amazing, but I am working on getting some, like a more universal, or I guess the AnyPin RAM is the most universal, but a less expensive, more application-specific product. Those should be coming in relatively soon.
It's his Diamond Lady.
Oh, yeah. But Gottlieb Games, that's a Gottlieb game, right? Yeah. Gottlieb Games, they didn't, their electronics didn't run on like the same standard stuff that like Williams and Data East and Stern and Sega and stuff used. I forget what kind of RAM that they used, but yeah.
I just sent you a Slack message for Nate later to look at it.
Okay, so I exposed a bit of wire. I stuffed it in the hole. I didn't tin it before I put it in the hole. Sometimes if you tin a wire before you try to put it in a hole, it could be too big and bulbous. I mean, just be careful. When you're stuffing a wire, a multi-strand wire through a hole, you want to make sure you don't flare it out. You don't want flares of wire sticking above the circuit board. You want them all sticking through the back. You will need to be concerned about, I can't get the light on this thing well. The insulation is basically stuck up against the board, so you might get some insulation melting against the top of the pad here. That is okay, but we do need to remember like the actual trace that connects to this pad is underneath, so we really want to make sure that this connection is good, but not apply too much heat to melt the insulation of the wire and get a bunch of impurities to come through the hole. You'd have to really hold this thing on there a long time to get something like that to happen. We are going to heat everything up, add a little bit of solder. It's flowing. I'm going to add solder, make a nice secure connection. not breathe in a bunch of nasty death smoke. That looks okay. I could add a little more solder. It's coming through the top a teeny bit, so I could definitely add a teeny bit more and it would make me feel better.
Nice.
And why wouldn't I do something that doesn't make me feel good? Be impulsive. All right, cool. Yeah, that looks good. I've zip tied the wire here. I have my black lead separate from my positive lead. I have the lead crimped down underneath the zip tie here to ensure that this thing won't rotate or anything like that. Now that I know that this side is in fine, I'm really going to crank down on the zip tie to keep it from moving. A lot of times when I install radial capacitors where an axial is, I like to use the groove as a point for the zip tie to hold on to. It gives it like an indented bit to really grip down on. But in that case, I'd have to shift this capacitor like a half inch this way, and it would be really close to this hole. So this will be acceptable. Am I talking too much? Has anyone learned anything? Maybe? This is like the longest power supply recap I've ever done, but I like it because it's refreshing things in my brain, too. It's a little bit too much wire exposed here. This is going to stick out significantly on the other side of the board. It's probably not focusing, but we can always snip it once it's on the other side. It is good to leave like some slack in these things too. If you solder them like super straight, like see how I have this kind of coming out at an angle and it's got some slack to wiggle? That's good. If anything ever hit this, it wouldn't be so tight that it might rip it out of the board. So you always want a little bit of like service wiggle, I guess. That's sticking through. We'll retin the iron.
Sorry, my mic died for a second.
Oh, I was wondering why it was so silent.
NetReamer asked if you learned not to leave old broken parts inside the game when done with the repair.
Nah. No. Why? It's a pinball machine's a good garbage can. You never have to empty.
Yeah, and they all like your talking. Besides everyone going back and forth between the difference between an arcade and a pinball tech, everyone seems to be working on their games right now while listening to you in the background. So
I think a lot. I mean,
some of us are here. Like,
a lot of video game techs are like
figure out what's going on.
Old school, and they like want to get in and out like fast. And I do see a lot of sloppy video game stuff, but video game stuff generally is a bit easier because you're just like swapping harnesses and pins. I mean, unless you get down to like real logic level stuff, but I can't tell you how many like effed up harnesses, like JAMA harnesses, or like, oh, this power supply died, so we're gonna put like a switching power supply in, and it's like nothing screwed down and power supplies are flopping around in the cabinet. Dude, it's so bad. I worked on a double dragon for this one dude and I felt so bad charging him as much as I did just because it took 6 hours to get this game like solid. It was a rat's nest, but the dude really wanted the game to work. He had it for a long time. I was like, okay, man. I gave him multiple outs. So what I'm doing here is I'm going to cut the zip tie, but I'm going to kind of use the pressure from the back of the pliers to like really get the last couple teeth out of it. Can't get any? Okay. It's my pet peeve when you don't cut zip ties like super flush and they like cut your hand. That really makes me angry. So I'm going to cut that super flush so it won't cut my hand. And voila! The logic and voltage section of this power supply is redone. Thumbs up. So now theoretically we could put this thing into the machine and it won't catch on fire and it will work forever, I hope. Before we put it in, there's a couple things I will kind of check. I'm going to throw the schematic on the floor and I will get my jeweler's loop and we are just going to look at some of the, where's my jeweler's loop? We're going to look for some of the connections to make sure we don't have cracked solder on, there it is, the header pins. A lot of times, like these big 0.156 header pins on single-sided boards, they crack a lot. They don't crack as much on dual-sided boards, but we have it out. It's a pain in the butt to get out. Let's do everything we can to try to make sure everything's okay. Using magnification is very helpful.
I used to work for because he did this all the time and he looked like a dork. Chris, I love you. But it really does help. I mean, I've got terrible vision. My glasses are super thick. But this will help you see things that, you know, you won't be able to see with your regular eye. Jeweler's loops are super handy for doing this kind of stuff.
Oh, can we look through it?
Sure. All of these look pretty good. I don't see any cracks. Generally, when you see cracked solder on these things, it's on the end pins because people like to pull these pins out like savages and they really bend the pins and it's bad. And again, like when I say that, the end pins being the ones on the furthest sides, people, instead of pulling them straight off, you know, wiggle, wiggle, wiggle up, they will just go and that puts a lot of stress on these end pins, which causes the connection on the bottom to break loose from its solder encapsulment. Looks great. Okay. Actually, that kind of works. That's kind of cool. Getting the focal length right is going to be impossible. Oh gosh, I can't translate my motions right. Okay, you saw enough. Anyways, yeah, this looks pretty good. I'd say that this thing's safe to put in. We already checked the fuses. I know the high voltage is working. Again, we're not replacing these capacitors because they generally don't go bad. They will go bad one day, but 30-something years on, they're still good. These capacitors, again, on a Bally game, they're very expensive because they're rated for like 300 volts. Again, an old Bally game, pre 85 or whatever. These guys are only rated for 160 volts. These would be cheaper, but in my experience, it's just a waste of time and money to do it. I'm not going to mess with it. The only other capacitor, electrolytic one, we didn't do is this guy down here, which is a filter capacitor for the 43 volts that runs the solenoids. Again, I have never seen that one go bad. I think we're okay. So yeah, that was a lot of talking, and maybe there's a lot of questions. I guess we could either throw this in the game really quick and just see if it works, or we can start Q&A now. Or I can go put it in the game while you guys are asking me questions, and that's probably what I'll do. Oh, wait, hold on.
He doesn't even give us a choice.
Nope. I'm the pinball dictator right now. Someone asked about Data East power supplies and the Data East system and how they are exactly like the Williams ones, and that's absolutely true. This is a Data East power supply. This is a Williams power supply. Like, they are pretty much interchangeable. The component layout is a little different, but they are essentially the same thing. The ins and outs are the same. Your AC for the general illumination comes in here. Your grounds, your AC for everything else comes in here. 12 volts ground and 5 volts comes out here. Feature lamps come out, or high voltage stuff comes out here for the display. They're exactly the same. And this one is hilarious because when you can't get an expensive 18,000 microfarad capacitor, what do? You run two 10,000 microfarad capacitors together in parallel. They're right next to each other in parallel. So this is really silly, but it's actually an effective fix. There is nothing wrong with this. Like, would I leave it that way if I was going to like sell this game with like good intentions and want someone to be able to enjoy their game forever? No. But if it was 8 o'clock on a Friday night at the arcade and I was not making money, I would absolutely do something like this. So I thought that was kind of funny. Okay, let me test this thing. I did find another power supply, like just laying in this building, another Williams power supply, and I tested it before we went live, and the 5 volts was good. So now I've got a nice spare. And it's a modern one. It's a Game 555, which Steve and I looked up, and that is millionaire. So it is like a System 11 era power supply. I'm pretty confident this will work. I mean, I'm very confident that it's going to work, but I don't want to screw it all the way in. So we'll just kind of do a proof of concept thing. Remember that the back of the board and installing these screws does provide another path to ground. So it is very important to screw all of your circuit boards down on this system. I mean, it's important to do on any system, but you know,
It's very important here because it does provide more ground. I'm going to put one in. AC inputs, we're going to put that in here. We've got ground. I'm going to put that in here. And I'm not going to plug anything else in. This is, gosh, I don't remember. This is your 12 volts and stuff out, so this will run the computer. This is your high voltage power stuff that plugs in here, your GI channels, the AC coming in for the GI. And this is either solenoids or flash lamps. I don't remember. I think this is this is feature lamps, and this is solenoid stuff. So yeah, what we'll do is we can power this sucker up. We're not going to see any signs of life because nothing is plugged in. The power supply is just doing its job right now. So what we can do is I could measure ground against the back of the head here. And I can measure on the hot side of the capacitor. And I have a good solid 13 volts coming in that eventually gets turned into 5. And then I think pin 4 or something on this connector is one of the 5-volt pins. And I have 4.94 volts, which is a bit low, but it's acceptable. The game, it's safe to turn on. Do we have any questions?
Yeah, like a million.
Oh my gosh.
What is the voltage it's supposed to be at?
Well, it should be running a teeny bit more than 5, but I think that there's a circuit in this power supply that will kind of range the voltage up. There's a little bit of fancy stuff going on in the circuit. This system isn't as susceptible to like the WPC games to voltage issues where they really, I think on a WPC game, if it goes under 4.8 volts, the game will just reset and crash. Which is good. It protects the game from doing damage to itself, but it's become a problem, as a lot of people who own WPC games probably know, especially in the last 5 years, which is a crazy topic to go over. I know a lot of people kind of want that to be done. The process is very well documented on PinWiki, but we could kind of go through a flowchart one day. Let's see. I'm going to ground the whole thing. Well, we'll see if that low voltage becomes a problem. I'm remembering, I think, that this thing does have a trick voltage regulator where if it senses, it'll kind of like mess with the voltage depending on the draw. Got that. So this is all of our logic. The power's 12. Still on. Don't do that. You're ground, 5 volts, 12 volts. This plug here is 12 volts, or no, it's 5 volts, positive 100 and negative 100. So this is going to your plasma displays. This is solenoids, I think. This one is feature lamps. I think I've got everything except for the AC for the GI. And we should have a running game. The program is running. Yay. So that's good. We can test. I can test what kind of voltage we're getting on the computer now also. So we could. Where's the 5-volt test point? There it is. OK. So I could use the ground test point here, the 5-volt here. And I've got a solid 4.9 volts at the computer. So this doesn't have that trick ranging power supply, but it's good enough to run for now. If the thing does end up resetting and doing weird stuff, we'll need to address that and figure out where the draw is. It could be a lot of things. Generally, it's not the regulator on this game, but yeah, no, it could be a lot of things. So be aware of that, or we will be aware of that. OK, get the questions done. I'm going to wash my hands. My voice hurts very bad, and I want to drink a sip of drink.
I think this is the fastest and longest Kyle has ever talked on any of these episodes. I don't think he even took a breath in between what he was saying. We do have a lot of questions loaded up. Luckily, you guys in the chat are awesome and responding to each other's questions. I'm going to throw in our free shipping link, too, because I haven't done that in a while. So we're just trying to keep up with Kyle today.
What? Oh man, did I talk too much again?
Ah, that felt good. That was fun. I have like 10 other games I need to basically go do almost all of that through, which will be interesting.
Awesome.
Emoto and I streamed on Sunday. I don't know if anyone tuned in. We were doing Ride of Pinbot. That was fun.
Kyle, can you hear me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, good. Jeez. So, luckily everyone's been talking to themselves while listening to you in the background. But a few questions, like Pinball122 on Twitch asked, how much would it be just to get a whole new board? Family Game said something around a System 11 is around 80 to 110.
Yeah, it's 100 something bucks. But the thing is like, you know, a lot of times it's not worth it to replace the board if it was something simple like that. Like, if you don't have the confidence to do that, but you have someone local who does, a job like that, you know, if I didn't spend an hour and a half explaining everything I was doing, I could get that done in about 20 minutes, and I would charge you $60 plus parts, right? So you would spend a lot less than getting a new, that it would cost to buy a new board. New circuit boards are great. They are a lot more modern, they use a lot more modern components, but the old boards are just as good. You need to be able to, you just need to fix the problems. And a lot of times those problems are very easily diagnosable by someone who knows what they're doing, and you can save money. Pro tip, just do not throw boards at a pinball machine. That is the best way to waste a lot of money and create a lot of problems. Figure out what's wrong with your game before spending a bunch of money replacing things that are perfectly fine.
That's a good tip. Bat Out of Hell by Meatloaf wants to know if we'll be doing any more intermediate and advanced episodes on CPU board work.
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, we're going to definitely do a Ramtron install on my roller games, most likely. We might do a Ramtron on this thing. When it comes to like logic level stuff, I am not comfortable talking from a point of authority about any of that stuff. So, you know, we'll definitely do some like semi-basic, you know, CPU kind of stuff, but I'm not gonna get into like oscilloscopes and stuff like that. I really wanna make sure I'm saying the right thing, and I'm not well-versed enough in that kind of stuff to speak at a sense of authority, so.
Sure. Family Games asked, what about recapping an MPU?
There aren't generally many capacitors you need to. It's not necessary most of the time. I can't think of any pinball MPUs that really you need to change capacitors on. I'm wrong a little bit, but like the WPC computer, there is a small 50 or 100 microfarad capacitor that's part of the 5-volt circuit, and when those things start to go bad, it can amplify reset problems. But it's not, you know, most of the capacitors in pinball that you need to replace are things on the power supply, for the most part.
Nice. Mofco just had a funny comment. He says, you guys rock. Felt more like junior high than third grade. Awkward and at times looks really difficult. I will second that. I felt like I was trying to take a college course and failing terribly.
Yeah, I guess it just depends on where you are in your soldering.
Candy Crush on my phone or something, because it got intense. But we'll get better. The more Kyle works on these and shows us how to do it, then we'll all get better at.
Yeah, hope so.
And watching the archives. I think watching the archives of the series will be valuable, especially when you're working on something like you're gonna do a System 11 recapping, having this episode up, so you're just kind of going scene by scene.
I tried to make that as like useful.
It would help me a lot in that sense.
I tried to keep that information generic enough to be able to use that information to just replace a through-hole capacitor on any sort of board. There was some information that was definitely like System 11 specific, but I guess when I, you know, not to like talk down and say like, oh, this is third grade.
It's like in the scheme of like.
You already did that, so don't worry.
In the scheme of working on circuit boards, replacing capacitors on an undamaged board is a very simple component swap out. So this is absolutely like in it's third grade of soldering, not third grade of like working on things, right? Like that is a very simple thing when it comes there. Now, when we're going to do a MPU. Installing an NVRAM, that's a lot more advanced. The traces are very small, they're very delicate. A lot of times they can be damaged on circuit boards that have corrosion. We will need to, you know, we're going to be installing a different size socket. We are going to be changing a jumper to change where the address bus addresses the RAM. This is a lot more advanced than just remove capacitor, replace capacitor. So I guess that's what I was trying to imply.
For sure. Netreamer asked, what if the problem is with an original Gottlieb System 1 board?
Throw it away. Throw it in the garbage. Smash it with a hammer. No, I'm just kidding. As Netreamer knows, I don't really work on tons of System 1 stuff. They're amazing machines. They're really cool. They don't get enough appreciation from internet pinball people. But the hardware is finicky, and it was finicky when it was new. Gottlieb was years, like 2 to 3 years late to the solid state pinball game. And by the time their system was released, it was already out of date. It's very weak compared to Bally and Williams offerings at the time. So, but they have their own unique sets of problems. The Gottlieb System 1 power supplies are strange. They're like just straight strange. If I had a System 1 game, I would keep the original supply, I would tinker with it, but it is much more reliable with that line of games to just replace the board. There are caveats to everything I say. I know I go against what I say a lot, but with the Gottlieb games, especially the System 1 game, sometimes a new board is the best option. That being said, I need to get a System 1 game. I really, really want a Close Encounters of the Third Kind. It's a bad game, but I love it. Pinball Pool, I think that's a System 1 game. I love that game. Cleopatra is really cool. A lot of those games are just fun, you know? There's fun.
Yeah, Pinball Pool. Incredible Hulk.
So, yeah, that's a cool one.
Yeah.
A lot of those early games, they're neat. They're just, they have a separate set of another skill set and thing you need to learn. Solar Ride, Countdown. I think I like Countdown a lot. I think that's the one where the spaceman, there's like that celestial lady outside his windows and she's like trying to hitchhike and he's like, I'm only going a little way, sorry. That's a fun game.
For sure. So next week we were going to do some more fireboard work. Is what we discussed, right? But now are we gonna just skip to the rectifier installation with some other stuff, or what are you feeling, Kyle?
So I think this computer on this fire
walks away.
Sorry, this.
It's okay. I'll follow you. Green can.
So this is not a. This is not the original computer for this game. This game, I can tell that for two reasons. I know that this is a System 11A. We kind of talked about that a little bit. System 11A computers ran on a 6116 RAM and had no provisions to install a different chip. The other way I can tell is that I have the serial number sticker on this board still, and it shows Project 567. And I know because I checked earlier today, Fire is project number 556. So this is from a later game. This computer does have the ability to install the 28-pin 6264 RAM chip, so we could RAMtron this game. That's totally possible. That's how I could tell. But I don't know, maybe we could do that. It depends on how long Bertok will let me borrow his solder sucker. I guess I should just buy one, because if I don't buy one, people in the chat are probably going to buy up the whole stock. But I would like to install these guys, but I'd really like to just get the game working. You know, This is a game that is for us to test, and it's going to be a fun game for us to have at Marco, but I don't think this game will ever go on location. Well, for now. But we'll see. I don't know. Putting a Ramtron in is a good thing, right? We're eliminating batteries. They'll never have the opportunity to leak, and it's not very expensive. It's just a lot of work. And when I look behind me and I see the pile of games that we also could be working on, we'll see. I would really like to do roller games. I'd like to get this game done to the point where it's like flippable, safe, fun to play, and then get to roller games. I don't know about you, Emoto, but...
Cool. So what do we need to do to fire right here to get it done and flippable?
Well, okay, we have safe power. We're good. We have a running computer. We're good. Other than that, I haven't checked much. We know we have sound. We know our display works. I did mess with the game just a teeny bit after we finished Pintech last week to see what kind of state it's in. And I've got like all the feature lamps work. I mean, I have some couple bulbs out. We'll look at that. All the solenoids work for the most part. I got all the motors to turn and stuff. But I think we're having some switch problems. And I don't know if that's due to a broken wire or a bad switch. I couldn't get a game to start because ball trough switch number 2 is not functioning. So the game can't see that there's 3 balls, so it won't start a game. I think we could either... I think it's probably better to Ramtron... We'll wait for the Ramtron lesson when we do roller games. Because I would like to show how to do the simple mod of installing fuses on the for these rectifiers here, and also kind of start working on the game. I think we might work on this game. We could probably only do it like one more week, maybe 2 weeks more of fire. We'll see. It depends on what's wrong, man. There could be a whole mess of crap underneath the play field on this thing, and we might be in for a real long ride, but we'll see.
Pinball 122 took a drink every time you said solder.
Solders? Oh, wow.
Pick a different word for next week. Remind us, we'll pick a word for you.
A drinking game? Can I participate in this drinking game?
And then, no, you can't. And Indie Pins, all those games in the background are actually just Kyle's personal games.
Yeah.
Right? Pretty much. And we decorated our little studio or our warehouse space to be a studio space, so we put up like our trust.
Yeah.
Kind of like what you would see at a show if we were doing shows.
It's crazy.
Yeah, look at this.
Well, if you
so we could make our own little Marco arcade studio with some of our backdrops and stuff like that. So this is just Kyle's collection. He's crazy.
Yeah. Most of it. I've got a few more games that are not here or set up, but I sold a lot of.
I would be a good game. Drinking word.
What's up? It's almost out of batteries.
So Kyle, just back to what we're going to be doing for next week. So you're settling on a rectifier mod and then just assessing more of the game component?
Well, we'll just jump in and finish fixing the game. Again, it's like I'm going to make the thing play. I'm not going to like do a full shop out and make the thing like location ready. It's going to get played by Steve and I when we come here to drink beer and maybe stream on a Tuesday night, right? So I will reduce the amount and quality of work, not quality, but it's the quantity of work I'll be doing on this game for now. But we'll do the basic stuff. Again, let's just get the game playing nice. I kind of wanted to not just like completely shop out and disassemble every single game we work on this show because it just gets tedious. Certain games we need to, but this game looks like it's in good enough shape where we won't have to. We'll install some LEDs.
We'll just be figuring out what we're going to do on the fly.
Yeah, again, I know we try to plan for everything, but man, it's like you can't plan for everything when it comes to fixing pinball stuff. You know, there could, like I said, there could be a big problem under here. We just don't know. Hopefully we'll be okay.
Yeah. So
really
maybe
quick.
This weekend we'll spend some research and figuring out what exactly we would be working on.
Yeah, maybe we'll go live again and finish up Bride of Pinbot. It's like it's so close to being done. As long as I could fix that relay board. But NetReamer did say show the proper procedure for finishing up with your solder sucker. I did turn it off. I had turned it back on. These things come with a tool. It's a little pin tool that fits inside the nozzle. So what you need to do very carefully, not to touch the hot nozzle, is you can stick this in the hole and drive it all the way through, and that will ream out any solder that might be stuck to the wall. It's very common, it happens all the time, for these things to get solder like stops, and then it doesn't work, and it's annoying, and you have to grumble and swear and take it apart, clean it out, and get it back to work. So that is the proper maintenance on one of these amazing devices.
Nice. Awesome.
So yeah, I think I will get roller games over here soon. I need to either bother someone with a truck to help me move it or shove it into my wife's Subaru. I am the annoying pinball guy that has never owned a truck and makes everyone with a truck help. Thank you, everyone who's ever helped me with a truck, if you're watching. But yeah, I can't wait to do roller games. I'm super stoked on those parts. It's going to be real fun. I'll post some pictures. I'll send them to Emoto. Maybe we'll put them on Instagram. I'll post them on my Instagram or something.
Yeah, you keep talking about it. We're waiting.
So stoked. Yeah, and what about Baywatch? Can we still talk about that? Can we still make that a meme? No?
What?
Baywatch. That's the game everyone always wants to do next, right? Baywatch.
Not anymore.
Aw.
Family Games had a great tip. If you have a label maker, make on the date when it was recapped.
Yeah, absolutely. I always do that for like batteries when I change out batteries. Rebuilding boards and stuff like that. I should have shown the sticker. There was a sticker on that thing that said the warranty ran out in August of 1989, 31 years ago. So this game, unfortunately, is not in warranty anymore.
Awesome. Well, it's about that time, folks. I'm going to drop that free shipping link.
Yeah, buy parts.
Down shipping for orders over $99 domestic. Link in there to thank you guys for hanging out with us. We're gonna raid someone on Twitch.
Yeah, we can't forget to do that. Is Small Town Pinball still on?
We got Flipper Liga Ludwigsburg. Wow, what a name. Small Town Pinball. Someone playing Space Cadet.
Oh, that's awesome.
And then Johnny Demonic.
Did you say Johnny Demonic?
We can never go wrong with Small Town Pinball, right?
Yeah, let's give him some love. But now I kind of want to make Johnny Demonic a pinball machine. Who's got a Johnny Mnemonic we can retheme?
Yeah, Johnny Demonic is playing Future Spot right now.
Oh, that is a dude's name. Oh, okay. Sorry. Hey, Future Spot's a great game.
We will see you next week, and we will probably be working on Fire, but who knows?
I think we'll most likely be working on
Follow us on Facebook and all that stuff, and we'll publish what we're working on, I hope.
You hope? We will.
We will. We will.
All right, thanks, all right. Y'all. That was
Goodbye,
fun.
Goodbye, everybody.
Raid,
play
raid.
Splash screen.
Raid,
splash
raid.
Splash screen never wants to play anymore.
Raid.
Raid.
Can I zoom in on something funny again like we did last time?
Oh, pretty.